What are these symbols? Okay, there's another one up here, and there's another one down just at the bottom, just off the bottom of the map. If we go across and have a look at our legend again, what we're looking at here is alluvial workings gold. So very, very handy to see that on the map. Hey guys, good to see you again. If we haven't met before, my name is Bruce, the part-time prospector. This is a follow-up video to one I made about a month ago about how to read geological maps. The first video really aimed at simplified geological maps, the common ones you find on Trilobite, GeoView, etc., and many of the other online mapping forums. These geological maps are great, don't get me wrong, they're super handy in finding out what the general lie of the land is. But there's a lot more geological information out there that has never made it to these online platforms, and in many ways probably never will. And there's enough information there to sort of take your prospecting up a notch if you make the effort to look into them. The geological maps I'm talking about here are the paper-based geological maps that haven't been turned into digital form, apart from just being run through a scanner. And they are non-queryable, so you can't go in and say, give me all the faults or give me all the granite, etc. But they're just a photo of an old paper map. Here's one I've got at the moment. And I'm going to swap this one out and turn this one off and turn on the quarter million map for Norseman. Now, Norseman, for those of you who don't know, and this is zoom out a bit, this is Western Australia. Perth is over here. Let's just change pens. So Perth's down here. Kalgoorlie's up here. Esperance is down here. This is the road you head off on to go to Adelaide. Norseman is at the junction of at the end of the air highway. And as you, most caravanners and prospectors who come in from the east will come in along this road and either turn north to go to Kal and onto Perth or down to the southwest. So this is the quarter million sheet in here. So let's zoom in. Now, one of the things that the DMIRS has done, Department of Mines has done here in Western Australia, is scan these old paper-based geological maps and actually geo-reference them, which is great. For those who don't know what geo-referencing means, it basically means they've actually embedded coordinates into the map so that when the scanned image is placed on a map, like I've just done here, it actually turns up in the right location. So if I, for example, go into here and just, if I start changing the opacity of this map, you can actually see how the roads, for example, along here, and if I go through here, you can actually see the same road lines up here. And if you look at that, you can see the salt lakes in the right position and the roads in the right position. So in other words, this map is correctly geo-referenced. So that is the data. It is available as JPEG 2000 files. It is available on the MERS website. And if anyone's interested, please drop a comment below and I'll provide the link on where to find this information. So let's have a look at the overall data sets that are here. And on this side, we have a legend. So a key, for want of a better word, of symbols. Down this side, we have a rock units, some information along the bottom and some cross sections. I'll cover each of these in turn. I'll start with the rock units. Now, each of these squares has a code inside it. Sometimes they have little symbols and textures, and you can actually look up, for example, QRA is a lacustrine deposit, basically means lake type deposits, edges of lakes, clay silt and clays and players, saline and difficult word to say. And so you can look down through all the rock units here. Now, these are the interesting thing about them is that this is not every rock unit known to man. These are only the units that appear on this map. The key thing to notice in this stuff is here is that these are in stratigraphic order, chronological, I should maybe correctly say, is that the rock units at the top are the youngest, rock units at the bottom are the oldest. So as we zoom down here, you can say the Penishaw formation, basically metabasalts and metadolerites, are the oldest units. And these lacustrine deposits at the top are the youngest ones, as you would imagine, salt lake deposits. So all this information here, and I'm just trying to get it in position, sorry, the end of zooming. So the information that goes from here to here is Archean. And this is the non-Archean information. So there's a bit of a gap between the break of the Archean Proterozoic and the younger information at the top. Continuing on down the bottom, so we've got a what they call the diagrammatic relationship of rock units. It's basically a cross-section explaining how the system works. We've got granites at depth. We've got greenstone belt, which has been stoped out by the granites. It's been, it shows you how the greenstone belts have been folded, twisted, and cross-cut by the Proterozoic dike running through the middle, as well as some major regional faults running through there. And then the yellow on top is the newer quaternary deposits. On the side here, we've got some information about magnetic declination, an index to adjoining sheets, very handy if you want to, for example, find out what's the sheet to the north or to the south. You can look it up here. And this map is an old map, and it shows because one of the first units on, say, on display here, it's saying it's 1 to 250,000, but it says it's in miles, and then in yards, and then kilometers. So if we look up the date on this map, and it's down the bottom here, 1972, not long after we were at metric. So you can see why a lot of these things would still have some of the old imperial units floating around. Then reliability diagram basically shows which bits have been visited the most and which have just been interpretive, where the map sits, and a flight diagram of air photos that were used in the compilation of this geological map. Now, when we go up the side, as I said before, here's a legend, a key of symbols on the map. So it shows you geological boundaries, faults, bedding. For example, it's got lineations and bedding, trend lines, cleavages, igneous banding, plunge of anticlines, drag folds, etc., etc. Again, the same as the rock units, the symbols here are not everything known to mankind, just the ones that appear on this map. So you've got different mineral types that have been found here. There's gypsum, tin, sand, uranium, zinc, etc., etc. So let's zoom into the geology bit, which is most interesting. Oh, one last thing. Now, on this map here, just try to squeeze it in, and I'll see if we can draw it with my drawing tool. We've got a point that starts at A, goes to B, and goes to C. Okay, and so that is a line that's drawn across the map. Down the bottom, we've got a cross-section across the entire countryside, and it is labeled A, B, and C. And so you can use this to guide, to say along that line, you can actually see the rock units and what their relationships are and what they're doing at depth. Now, this is quite a coarse scale, obviously sea level there and 10,000 foot below. So it's quite a coarse scale, highly vertical exaggerated, but it gives you a good idea of what's happening with the rock units. So let's go back to this unit up here, and let's zoom into here. So in this map here, what we can see is that this blue represents a banded iron formation, or BIF, running up through here. It continues over here. At this side, we've got some metabasalts. Out here, we've got basalts and sediments occurring. But one of the interesting things that you don't get on the other maps are these symbols out here, etc. Now, this one out here, this is an upside down pick and shovel, represents it's a quarry. GP stands for gypsum. So that's a gypsum quarry. Not an unusual place to have it on the edge of a salt lake, natural source of gypsum. SD is sand. So again, you can see sand deposits. But as we go up here, this is the example I wanted to show, and I'm pushing it in quite hard here, is that we've actually got mines around the place, and we've got the names. So we've got, for example, down here, we've got the Phoenix, we've got the Crown, we've got the Regent, we've got the Northern Star. Down here, we've got the Iron King and the Cumberland. These are all names of the mines that occur here. But also, if you look at some of these symbols, what are these symbols? Okay, there's another one up here, and there's another one down just the bottom, just off the bottom of the map. If we go across and have a look at our legend again, oops, go down, what we're looking at here is alluvial workings gold. So that very, very handy to see that on the map. So you could drop a pin, record that in your GPS, and if this ground was available, you could go and see it. Now, guys, just because I'm showing you this here does not mean this ground is available. If we turn on our tenement boundaries and we go and look at live tenements, this entire area is blanketed by active mining leases. Do not go on this ground. This ground is not open, it is closed. But I'm showing you what the geological maps represent. Turning that off. So there's a lot of information in these maps that you do not get inside the simplified geological maps that you get in things like Trilobite. So these, what do you call them, alluvial workings, would be a very handy target to go and hit to see for some metal detecting prospecting. Now, there's two lots of geological maps. Now, as I said before, so I'm going to zoom out. So what we've got here is the 250,000 map. And this is the entire state has been mapped at 250,000 geology. We've also got 1 to 100,000 scale mapping. So this is the 100 scale sheet index for basically all of WA. Each one has a name, each one has a references. And so some of them have geological mapping. This is a much higher detailed mapping. And I'm turning this one off and I'm putting on the 1 to 100,000. And you can see that's where the Norseman one sits. Not all the 100,000 sheets have geological maps attached. It is a work in progress for the GSWA, Geological Survey of Western Australia, which do a stand-up job in mapping these sheets for us. Without them, we'd be stuffed, basically. So they take a long time to make, and they are available from the MERS. Same bit, looking at that same area. Oh, sorry, we'll just jump out the regional area. As you can see, they are pretty much the same sort of thing. Map, title along the top, cross-section along the bottom based on a line across the map, rock units down the side. Again, a legend for a key to symbols and other information about date and everything else. Now, this one was mapped much more recently. So if we zoom into the corner, we can see this was actually first edition 1993. So this was nearly, 20 years after the last one. So it is a much more recent map. You don't have to have something in this century because guess what? Geology doesn't change that often. So one of the nice things about this one is that when you zoom into the details, it's nice and clean and sharp. And you see that how they've actually mapped on some of the faults. I'm trying to draw on top of them, but I'm not the best. And they've also got these other structures running through here. You've got, again, the mines through the area, a lot more detailed mine mapping. And again, the mapping of the BIF running through here. If we go to the top where we saw those alluvial workings on the 250,000 sheet, which was in here, you notice there's no alluvial workings marked. It does show that there's information on one set of maps, which is not on another set of maps. One of the things you can do with these maps, which is great, and I've done it many times, let's zoom out a bit, is you can start overlay information. So what we can do here is we can go and grab, for example, the geophysics reverse dipole. And so we can turn this one on. Okay, so here's the geophysics. The red values represent magnetic highs, basically magnetically strong rocks with high iron content. In this case, it is the banded iron formations. And so we've got it on top. And so what we can do is start changing the opacity of the layers. And as you start to change the layers, you can start to see how they line up. And so There's some interesting information you can see which is not obvious on the mapping, but as it comes through up top here and continues along here. There's some dikes obviously running through here which have never been mapped before. It's probably because they don't outcrop. Okay, remember this is only an outcrop map, not a map of at depth. But it's easy enough again in this one here, if we zoom down here, to see that there's a fault that runs down through here. Just change the pen. And there's another one that runs through here. And another one runs through what looks like about down here somewhere. Okay, so if we swap out our opacity, you can see they line up pretty well with the interpreted faults there. So that gives us confidence that if we go looking further along here and seeing breaks through the banded iron formations down here, there's almost certainly that we're sitting on another fault somewhere through here and possibly another one through there. And so we could start doing our own interpretation that has some basis in fact. So that's about it. These geological maps are very, very handy. They're available from the DMP, or DMPE now they're called, or the old DMERS. And if anyone's interested, please yell out and I will provide a link in the comment if anyone's interested to where you can go and download them. And so if you've got some value out of this video, I'd love it if you could give me a thumbs up, a comment if you're using these sort of maps already, and if you haven't subscribed, guys, I really, really would appreciate it if you would subscribe. Thanks, guys, and we'll see you on the next video.